हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम बैक। माई सेल्फ पुष्पेंद्र सिंह एंड वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट विद अवर डेली करंट अफेयर्स। सो टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू कवर विद करंट अफेयर्स फॉर द 21st of January 2021। एंड हियर बेसिकली आई एम रेफरिंग द टू नेशनल न्यूज़पेपर्स। यू आर ऑलरेडी अवेयर अबाउट इट। द फर्स्ट इज बेसिकली द हिंदू। दिस इज द मोस्ट इम्पॉर्टेंट, आई मीन for your daily current affairs you must read the Hindu newspapers for the UPSC examinations, especially the UPSC civil services examinations, all right, as well as the other newspaper, which is Indian Express. Okay, though both of these newspapers are equally good, you can refer any of these newspapers. All right, I will recommend you to refer the Hindu newspaper for your civil services examination or any examination conducted by the UPSC for your the daily current affairs. All right, so let's begin with the lecture. All right, so the first is basically the second edition of India Innovation Index. All right, so this second edition, so it was the second edition, means it is the second time which is basically published such index in India. So first such index, which is also known as India Innovation Index, was published in 2019. All right, so it is the second such index which was basically published in India. Now, who published this index? This index is published by NITI Aayog along with the Institute for Competitiveness. All right, so NITI Aayog and Institute for the Competitiveness basically released this edition of Innovation Index this year. So it is the second edition of, you know, the India Innovation Index. Now, what is this Institute for Competitiveness? That you must understand. So first of all, the Institution for Competitiveness basically located at Gurgaon. Okay, it is located at basically Gurgaon. Okay, which is in Haryana. Now, what is this Institute for Competitiveness? First of all, you must understand, the Institute for Competitiveness is basically a part of a global Institute for the Competitiveness. So you can say it is a India knot in the global network for the Institute for making the strategy and the competitiveness at the Harvard School. All right, Harvard School of Business. So the Institute for the Competitiveness basically, right, in India is an international initiative. It is an international initiative centered in India, with the help of the Harvard School of Business. The main purpose of establishing of this Institute for Competitiveness in India is to dedicate, to enlarge, and the purposeful disseminating of the body of research and knowledge on competitiveness and the strategy, right? So it is basically institute which is basically working in that direction. So about the index, first of all, this Innovation Index 2020 basically examines the innovation capabilities as well as the performance of the states and the union territories. So, all right. So it is basically, you know, making the ranks, or it is basically assessing, right, or examining the capabilities as well as the performance of the states as well as the union territory. So it is basically the India specific rank, which is basically published, right, as a second such rank in the year. All right. And in the ranking or in the performance, the states have been divided into various categories. So the first category is basically related to the major states category. In the major states category, right, the Karnataka basically top the list. So Karnataka basically at the top of the list, which is basically at the first position in terms of innovation capabilities, in terms of the performance, right? And all right. And Tamil Nadu basically stood to the third position. So Maharashtra basically moved past to the Tamil Nadu to reach to the second place this year. All right. Then the four southern states basically occupied the top five spots, apart from your Maharashtra that we have discussed just now. So the four southern states, Karnataka at the first position, then Maharashtra, then Tamil Nadu, then Telangana, and then Kerala, right? These are basically, or the Karnataka, Maharashtra, Tamil Nadu, Telangana, and Kerala, basically these are the top five spots under major states category in the India Innovation Index this year. All right. And when you compare, this is basically, the rank of the major states. When you compare in terms of overall ranking, right, the Delhi retained the first rank, or Delhi retained the first position. Okay. Chandigarh basically made, when you compare the position of the Chandigarh, right, since 2019, the Chandigarh this time, you know, occupied the second place this year. So Chandigarh also made a great leap since 2019 and had occupied the second position this year. So overall, in the overall category, Delhi occupied the first rank. All right. And when you compare with the northeastern states, as the states means, just like Himachal Pradesh, Uttarakhand, right? Northeastern states means those states which are lying basically in the northeastern states. So they are also called the eight sister states. All right. So when you compare with the northeastern states or hill states category, okay, the Himachal Pradesh basically stood or moved up from the second position to emerge as a top ranker. So this ranking basically is done based on certain divideation or certain, you know, categorization of the states. So first categorization is based on the major states, which means in terms of area. All right. Second, basically in terms of the overall ranking. So Delhi retained the first spot in terms of the major states. The Karnataka retained the first spot in terms of the hilly states and the northeastern states. This is the one group of one category of the states. In this, the Himachal Pradesh basically, you know, topped this year. All right. And what are the parameters which we use basically this year? So parameters we use basically, right? You know, the five enabler parameters, right? Based on which the assessment of the innovation capabilities have been assessed or examined, right? And the output through two performance parameters. So output is basically assessed through two performance parameters and input basically assessed through the five enabler parameters. So what are these, you know, these parameters that we have to look into? So first of all, the enabler parameters, right, for the state to perform or to have, you know, the potential in terms of innovation, right? The enabling parameters is basically the human capital, right? Obviously, the human capital is the most important, right? Without human capital, you cannot innovate anything. So human resources and better human resources, human capital is at most importance, right? For developing or for innovating anything, right, in any field, all right, not only in India, but also in the world also. So it is basically the most important enabler, right, most important enabler parameter in terms of assessing of the potential of the states or innovation potential of the states. All right, second is investment. Obviously, the investment is also most important because for any, you know, innovation to succeed, first of all, you need to build that associated infrastructure. You need to invest, right, for research and the development, isn't it? Then you need to make some sort of, you know, certain set of parameters. Then you need to design it for it. And then you need to manufacture for that, right? So certain set of investment is also required for any, you know, innovation to succeed. Second, the knowledgeous workers. Obviously, the workers should be updated in terms of their knowledge, right? What is, you know, in terms of, you know, what is the demand and what is supply. So that should be matched. So they should be properly skilled, right? So knowledge of the workers should be up to date. All right. And the next is basically the business environment. So environment should be in such a way that it should not, you know, comes in between the innovation. That means you should have, first of all, you know, the single window clearance facilities, right? The ease of doing business, isn't it? Right? Corruption-free atmosphere, isn't it? So all sort of a, you know, associated, you know, parameters are also helpful in terms of the business environment. Then safety and the legal environment, which is also important for performance of, or for for any sort of a, you know, innovation to be succeed. So they are also known as enabling parameter or enabler parameters, right? And the last is basically in terms of performance parameters, right? What are the performance parameter? After you put everything as an enabler parameter, right? What did you get or what do you get after that? So that is performance parameter. So what did you perform for that? So first of all, in terms of knowledge output and in terms of knowledge diffusion, all right? They are basically chosen as a performance parameter for assessing the innovation, right? Among the states as well as the union territory this year, by the Niti Aayog as well as the Institute for Competitiveness, which is basically located at the Gurgaon, right? All right. So it is basically a logo for India Innovation Index, which is basically, you know, released by the Niti Aayog associated with or along with, you know, the Institute for Innovation. All right. Next, ड्रैगन फ्रूट, यू माइट हैव सीन दिस फ्रूट ऑल्सो. सो फर्स्ट लुक एट द फ्रूट, देन विल कवर द न्यूज. ऑलराइट, सो फर्स्ट लुक एट द फ्रूट. ऑलराइट, सो दिस इज बेसिकली अ ड्रैगन फ्रूट. सो यू सी बेसिकली द पिंकिश अपियरेंस, यू नो, फ्रॉम आउटसाइड एज वेल एज यू नो द व्हाइटिश अपियरेंस हियर, एंड स्मॉल स्मॉल सीड्स आर ऑल्सो स्कैटर्ड ओवर देयर. सो इट इज बेसिकली अ ड्रैगन फ्रूट. इट इज बेसिकली अ ड्रैगन फ्रूट. ऑलराइट, सो लेट्स अंडरस्टैंड व्हाई इट इज इन द न्यूज. इट इज इन द न्यूज बिकॉज the Gujarat government is basically decided to rename this fruit, which is also known as dragon fruit, as the kamalam. So it is decided to rename the dragon fruit as a kamalam. All right, so first of all, let's understand what is the dragon fruit. So dragon fruit is a fruit of a species of wild cactus, right? It is a fruit of a species of wild cactus, which is basically indigenous. Indigenous means it is only found, right, in the southern and the central America at the initial phase of the time. So it is basically indigenously grown or grown in the wild in southern America as well as in the central America, right? In the southern America as well as in the central America, it is also known as pitaya, or it is also known as pitaya, right? So in the southern America and the central America, this fruit is known as pitaya. So it is a fruit of species of wild cactus, which is indigenously grown in the southern and the central America. All right, the fruit flesh, you know, the Buddha jisko bolte hain, fruit ke andar ka jo hota hai, right? So that fruit flesh normally white. So when you see this figure also, it is white, right? So it is fruit flesh, it is white. Sometime it may also red, or it may also have the yellow pitaya also, but it is not that much common. Okay, so usually the fruit flesh is generally white or red, but sometime it may also have the yellow pitaya also, right? And it is basically studded with the tiny seeds rather than like kiwi fruit. So if you have seen the kiwi fruit also, the tiny seeds are there in this dragon fruit. So you can see here, it is basically studded with this tiny seeds. Okay, you can have this fruit. All right, next, in terms of the production, in terms of, you know, exporter, right? The Vietnam is the largest producer as well as the largest exporter of the dragon fruit in the world. All right, so it is the world largest producer and the world largest exporter of the dragon fruit in the world. So that is Vietnam. All right, and in the Vietnam, it was not native. First of all, the dragon fruit was not native. It was introduced by the French in the 19th century as a colonizer. So in the 19th century, French basically introduced, right, the dragon fruit in the Vietnam as a colonizer, right? And in the Vietnam, it is known as the dragon's eye, or it is known in the Vietnamese language as, you know, Tan Long. Tan Long, that means a dragon's eye, right? So it is basically believed to be origin of its common English name. All right. And as I told you, in terms of their cultivation, right, in terms of cultivation, apart from the Southern America, apart from the Latin America, right, it is also grown in Thailand. It is also grown in Taiwan, China, Australia, Israel, and Sri Lanka. Now, this fruit have been introduced, right, by the colonial masters, right? Now, in terms of India, it has been brought in India in 1990s, right? And it has been now growing in the several states, for example, in the Karnataka, Kerala, Tamil Nadu, Maharashtra, Gujarat, Odisha, West Bengal, Andhra Pradesh, and Andaman and Nicobar Islands. So in the many states, it has been growing, right? And the special feature of this fruit is basically it can grow on any kind of soil. So that means for all soils, it can be grown, right? And the most important feature is also it does not require the much water. That means it can sustain even in semi-arid environment also, and it can be grown in all types of soil also. All right, so it is basically a dragon fruit, which is basically in the news. All right, let's understand the next news. All right, okay, next is Netaji Express. So first of all, let me clear, the government of India has decided to celebrate the birthday of Netaji, right, as a Parakram Divas, right? As I told you in the last class, so the birthday of Netaji basically on 23rd of January. So he had the birth on 23rd of January. So on that day, right, the first of all, you know, the Netaji was born, and government of India, to in order to celebrate, right, his birthday, right, has decided to celebrate this day as a Parakram Divas, and is already notified in the government gazette or government notification that we have covered in the last class, in the last news. All right. And now Narendra Modi also decided that a train which is also known for its oldest train in India, right, which is also known as Howrah Kalka Mail. So this basically connect the Howrah in the Kolkata to Kalka. Okay, this is the basically the longest route, one among the longest train, which basically Calcutta connect with the Calcutta to the Kalka. Now the Prime Minister Narendra Modi basically decided, or the Indian Railway basically decided, to rename this oldest train, right, which is also known as the Howrah Kalka Mail, as a Netaji Express. Why they have decided to rename it as a Netaji Express? Because it is basically, you know, known that, right, the Netaji basically took this train from Gomo station in the Bihar, right, after he escaped from a house in the Kolkata in 1941. So it is in the memory of Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose that he has traveled in this train, right, from Bihar, right, especially from the Bihar, as he was escaped from Calcutta basically in 1941. All right. And regarding this train, which is also known as the Howrah Kalka Mail, this mail was started in the 19th century, right, as the early commercial passenger train service in our country. All right. And this Howrah Kalka Mail basically enjoyed the, you know, continuous patronage and the popularity which connect basically the Howrah and the Kalka in our country. All right. Next, the geohazard management. So first of all, geohazard management, what are the geohazards? The geohazards means it is related to hazard, means which can, this is basically causing certain set of, you know, the destruction, certain set of, you know, devastation. So it is basically element of devastation is involved. Okay, so it is called hazard that may have the loss of men, materials, and etc. Geo means earth related hazard or earth related loss. So earth related hazard means you may have landslides, right? So all such landslides may also part of your geo hazard. So geo hazard management, right? How to manage that geo hazards that occur basically, especially in the hilly areas, in the steep terrain areas, right? In the basically in those areas where, you know, the terrain is not plain. So here the news is the Defense Research and the Development Organization, which is also known as DRDO, right, has basically entered into a MOU with the Ministry of Road Transport and the Highways to strengthen the collaboration of sustainable geohazard management, especially in those areas where the avalanches, right, certain set of, you know, landslides generally occur, right? So here it has been, you know, in the MOU. So DRDO basically signed an MOU with Ministry of Road Transport and the Highways, right, to have the sustainable geohazard management, especially in those areas. So the DRDO's, the Defense Geoinformatics Research Establishment, which is basically a part of DRDO, is working for the development of critical technologies for enhancing the combat effectiveness in the various kinds of terrains and the avalanches, right? So what is happening is, since our, you know, the armed force personnel are basically working, or they are basically, you know, deployed in certain areas which are very rough, which are, you know, prone to such hazard or prone to geo hazards, right? If such hazards occur, obviously we lost our personnel, especially from the armed forces, right? So in order to save that crucial life, and moreover, whenever such geo hazards occur, it also blocks all traffic. So that means it also causes inconvenience to the movement of the troops also, and to the normal public also, right? So now this, you know, the DGRE, which is a DRDO's, you know, Defense Geoinformatics Research Establishment, is basically working for the development of the critical technologies, right, for the enhancement of combating effectiveness in those areas. Now, as you know, that Ministry of Road Transport and the Highways, this is the nodal ministry for the development and the maintenance of national highways across the country, right? So whatever the national highways basically passes through, they comes under the central government jurisdiction, and the Ministry of Road Transport and the Highways is the nodal ministry for the development, for the maintenance of such highways in our country. All right. And the expertise of the DGRE will be utilized, right, for sustainable mitigation measures, for development of critical technologies, right, for, you know, for managing such damage which is caused by the landslides, avalanches, especially in those areas which is basically having, you know, the hilly terrain or steep terrain, right? And you know, especially when the, you know, the national highways also passes through those terrains. All right, so this is the picture you can see here. The national highway is passing, and this is basically a landslide where, you know, even after, you know, this fencing, geofencing, all right, geofencing is clearly visible. Even after that, also the landslide basically occurred, and which is basically causing, right, you know, lot of, inconvenience to the people also. All right, next. The fifth India-Singapore Defense Ministers Dialogue. So first of all, as name itself suggests, it is a fifth such dialogue, right, between the defense ministers of Singapore and defense minister of India, right? So that means that it is the dialogue between the defense ministers of Singapore and the India. So it is a fifth such dialogue which was successfully held, right, on 20th January 2021 through a video conferencing. Okay, so why the video conferencing here? Because of Corona and because of all such, the uncertainties it's caused to, to the world. So now through the video conferencing, fifth such dialogue between the Defense Minister of India and the Singapore was held recently on 20th January 2021, right? And both of these ministers, first of all, signed, implementing the agreement on submarine rescue support and the cooperation between the two navies. All right. So both of these basically nations signed the implementing agreement on submarine rescue support, because submarine now because of this, warfare tactics and because of this, the threat that is coming from, especially from say Pakistan or, some of the Chinese, the submarines also found in the Indian waters, right? So this agreement would be of greater importance for the India as it is a bilateral, right? And this agreement on the submarine rescue support and the cooperation, especially on the humanitarian grounds, right, is a welcome, step between the two navies, which will be cooperating in such rescue support as well as in the cooperation between these two navies, right? Especially in the submarine, right? And the ministers or both of the defense ministers further, welcome the implementing agreement on humanitarian assistance and the disaster relief cooperation in August 2020, right? So here you must understand both of these armed forces belongs to the Singapore as well as the India. Both will be implementing, right, this humanitarian assistance and the disaster relief cooperation, right, especially, during the case of disasters, right? Let's say tsunami occurs, or earthquake occurs, or any sort of a disasters it occur, right, the humanitarian assistance and the disaster relief would be provided to either country, right, in the case of need. So both defense ministers also, welcomed such implementation measures. All right, and the ministers are pleased that Indian Navy and the Singapore Navy successfully conducted the 27th edition of Singapore-India Maritime Bilateral Exercise. This Singapore-India Maritime Bilateral Exercise is also known as SIMBAX. It is also SIMBAX. So here only maritime exercise is there, right? There is no military exercise or there is no Air Force exercise. Only the maritime exercise is there. So both Indian Navy and the Singapore Navy both are involved. And it is a 27th edition. That means 27 such exercises has already been conducted under the name called SIMBAX, right? And both of these also participated, right, in the second edition of the Singapore-India-Thailand Maritime Exercise, which is also known as SITMAX. So here, the maritime exercise involved the Singapore, India, as well as the Thailand, which is also known as SITMAX. Both of these exercises, SIMBAX and SITMAX, both of these exercises basically held, right, in November 2020, right? So both were basically, or both ministers basically pleased for this, for conducting or for successfully conducting the SIMBAX and SITMEX exercise, which is basically, you know, the maritime bilateral exercise between the Singapore and the India as the SIMBEX, between Singapore, India and the Thailand maritime exercise as a SITMEX, as a SITMEX exercise. And Rajnath Singh, who is basically also a defense minister, reformed the ASEAN reality, right? So Association of Southeastern Asian Nations, so that is ASEAN. So Rajnath Singh basically, you know, reformed the Asian centrality in terms of the regional security architecture, right? And Rajnath Singh also pledged the India support to all adventures, right, of the Asian Defense Ministers meeting plus, that is ADMMM plus platform. So India extended all such support to all such endeavors for the ADMM plus platform. All right. And the cyber agencies of both of these armed forces are also involved or also stepped up in the engagement process, right, for further engagement. All right. So this is the picture you can see here. It is a Singapore, right? And it is basically the peninsular Malaysia. It is Indonesia. It is Strait of Malacca. It is the South China Sea where a lot of disputes are there, right? The China basically occupied, illegally occupied certain islands over there. Okay, so many such disputes are lying over in South China Sea. All right, let's understand the next news, the Rattle Hydropower Project. So first of all, the Rattle Hydropower Project is basically located in the Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir, right? It has been, Jammu and Kashmir have been recently reorganized as a Union Territory. So Rattle Hydropower Project is basically there in the Kishtwar district of the Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir. Okay, this Rattle Hydropower Project, first of all, would be located on the Chenab River, would be located on Chenab River, which flows through Jammu and Kashmir. Okay, now why it is in news? It is in news because the Union Cabinet, you know, gave its approval for the investment of 5,281 crore rupees, right, for 850 megawatt Rattle Hydropower Project, right, which will be located in the Kishtwar district of Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir. So it is a hydroelectric power project. That means the electricity would be generated through this hydro project, through this hydroelectric project. All right. Next, here, this project or Rattle Hydropower Project will be implemented by a new joint venture company. So here, new joint venture company will be there. This new joint venture company will be incorporated between the National Hydroelectric Power Corporation, so that is NHPC, as well as the Jammu Kashmir State Power Development Corporation, which is also known as JKSPDC. Both of these are basically, one is basically the central PSU or the central government hold PSU, that is called National Hydroelectric Power Corporation, NHPC. And the second is basically the Jammu and Kashmir PSU, so which is also known as state PSU. So Jammu and Kashmir State Power Development Corporation. So both of these PSUs are basically involved in a formation of, you know, a joint venture company, right? So this project will be implemented by the joint venture company. In this joint venture company, the NHPC will have the stake of 51%. That means NHPC will hold the majority stake in the joint venture company, and Jammu and Kashmir State Power Development Corporation Limited will hold the 49% stake in the Rattle Hydroelectric Power Project. And it has been, you know, decided that the Rattle Hydroelectric Power Project will be commissioned within a span of 60 months. So in the 60 months, the Rattle Hydropower Electric Project will be commissioned, right, in the Kishtwar district of the Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir. All right. So you can see the picture of a hydroelectric power project. All right. Next, the fecal sludge and septage management. Okay. So you know about, you know, the fecal sludge. Sludge means it's a dirty, you know, the dirty, you know, the water which basically comes out, or right. So that is fecal, which means certain set of, you know, bacteria, viruses are there, right? For how to manage that septage and the fecal sludge. So that is the full name called fecal sludge and septage management, right? So that it should not, you know, pollute the soil. It should not pollute the environment. It should not pollute, you know, the water bodies, right? Groundwater aquifers and etc. So here the Niti Aayog basically released a book on the fecal sludge and septic management, which is also known as FSSM in the urban areas, right? So here, this is basically, you know, jointly developed, or this book is jointly developed, right, with, you know, the National Fecal Sludge and Septage Management Alliance, which is basically, you know, basically alliance of the management of such sludge and the septage, right? This book basically, you know, represents or presents 27 case studies across 10 states in our country, right? And, you know, various business models adopted by the Indian cities. It is also there. It is also description of such various services which have been provided by the Indian cities, various business models which have been implemented by the Indian cities, right, while implementing the fecal sludge and the septic management. So it is basically a book which will have in the form of an informatory book which can be used as a base for the better fecal sludge and septic management in our country, right? And this report mentioned, or this report also gave some data regarding, you know, 60% of the urban household in our country rely on the on-site sanitation systems, right, for the fecal management, right? And this on-site sanitation system basically require, you know, a proper planning of management of the waste, because if you do not collect the waste, obviously it will be lying on the roads or somewhere, and it will basically cause another set of pollutions, right? Many such diseases also occur because of, not properly managing this solid waste or any sort of a fecal waste, right? So the proper planning for the collection of the waste is very much needed, right? Especially in these systems where you have the containment structures, all right? And the fecal, you know, first of all, the fecal sludge and septage management planning basically prioritize the human excreta, management, because it is also a part of the fecal, you know, the management. So, you know, if that human excreta basically goes through, you know, through the waste stream, right, to the water bodies, it has a very high potential for spreading that disease, right? So it can cause the waterborne diseases to the native population, which basically consume that water. Okay. So you can see basically the sanitation value chain here. The person who is basically sitting in the toilet or latrine here, right? So here you see basically it is a septic tank. So whatever the fecal, the remains comes out, it will go here and it will go to the septic tank. It is a septic tank. Okay. And here, you know, the van which is there, which is basically collecting this excreta here and then transporting it to certain, you know, containment structure, and then ultimately, you know, treating it. So treatment here is most important. So fecal sludge and septage management, so here the treatment is most important after, you know, putting it into some sort of a bin, and then this after treatment you can use it, right, or you can dispose it. So idea is to collect that, you know, to collect that fecal, right, to treat it, right, properly, so that it can be either reusable or it can be disposed. But the point is that after disposing, it should not pollute the environment, right? Because if it is polluting the environment even after disposal, then what is the use of treatment of such the, you know, fecal remains? The point is that you should treat in such a way that it can be either reusable or it can be disposed without much causing harm to the environment in terms of pollution, in terms of leaching to the water bodies, in terms of contamination of the water structure, right? It should not cause such type of things. All right. Next, the National Startup Advisory Council. So let's understand the National Startup Advisory Council. So here, the government of India nominated 28 non-official members, right, on the National Startup Advisory Council. So it is a newly set up council. First of all, it has been newly set up by the government of India, right? To build a strong ecosystem for, you know, innovation and the startups in our country, right? So to nurture such startup and the innovation in our country, the National Startup Advisory Council was set up. This National Advisory Council basically consisting of the 28 non-official members. So central government already nominated the 28 non-official members, these 28 non-official members includes, you know, the Baiju. Baiju platform, you know, it is a basically a online platform. The Baiju CEO, Baiju Ravindran, basically a member, as a non-official member of the National Startup Advisory Council. Ola Cab co-founder Bhavish Agrawal is also a member. All right. The Kalari Capital Managing Director, Vani Kola, is also, you know, the non-official member. And SoftBank India country head, the Manoj Kohli, is also the non-official member of National Startup Advisory Council. All right. Let's understand a brief description about the National Startup Advisory Council. So I told you that the Department for the Promotion of Industry and International Trade, which is comes under, right, you know, Ministry of, right. So it is basically a you know, DPITT, which is basically constituted the council or the National Startup Advisory Council on January 21st, 2020. The idea of creation of this National Startup Advisory Council, right, to build a strong ecosystem for innovation, for nurturing innovation as well as the startups in our country. And that is the reason the, you know, many such founders of the startups like Baiju, Ola, right, Kalari Capital is basically also a part of this advisory council. Okay. The term of such non-official members, right, of this council shall be for 2 years or until further orders. So you know, the tenure will be 2 years or until further orders. So they will be continue to hold the post until further orders, right? And the council basically chaired by a commerce minister. So commerce minister right now is Piyush Goyal. So Piyush Goyal will be chairing this, you know, council. Other members which are part of this council basically includes the Just Money CEO, the Lizzie Chapman, right? The Urban Company co-founder, the Avira Singh Bal, right? And, you know, the Krish Gopala Krishnan of the Axilar Ventures, the Renuka Ramnath from the Indian Private Equity and the Venture Capital Association, the Uday Kotak of the Confederation of Indian Industry, CII, right? And the Uday Shankar of the Federation of Indian Chambers of Commerce and Industry, FICCI, right? They are also the members of such council. All right. Then too big to fail list. So it is basically, you know, the list is given by, first of all, the Reserve Bank of India every year. Okay. The Reserve Bank of India basically, you know, define, right, banks in terms of the domestically systematic important banks, right? These domestic systematically important banks are also called too big to fail, right? Or they are also called the banks that are too big to fail, right? Many such economists also claim that why we call them too big to fail, because if they fail, they will have the serious repercussions or the serious impact on the economy of the India, right? If they fail. So the Reserve Bank of India has retained or has made a list this year, and among this domestically systematically important banks, the State Bank of India is a part, the ICICI Bank and HDFC Bank, both three are basically part of DSIB, or their banks are also called too big to fail, right? Here, you know, this scheme of mentioning the bank was basically started in July 22, 2014. So Reserve Bank of India has started issuing the framework for dealing with the domestically systematic important banks on January 22, 2014, right? So here, certain set of, you know, extra requirement or extra compilation, right, is there in terms of the banks which are involved in the domestic systematically important banks. So the framework require, right, such banks or the Reserve Bank, first of all, to disclose the names of such DSIBs, right, which basically started from 2015 onwards. And the Reserve Bank of India basically place such banks, right, on such, you know, the regulatory buckets where, you know, certain, you know, systematic importance scores will be based, right? And based on that bucket, right, the domestically systematically important banks will be placed, and it will also have the additional common equity requirement that has to be applied to such banks also, right? And as I told you that according to many such analysts as well as the economists, the too big to fail phrase, which is basically used for DSIBs, are basically to describe the such banks, right, or such companies, right, if they fail, that will have the catastrophe or that will have the serious repercussions on the economies of the country, right? And here, in case of a foreign bank, the branch presence in India is also globally systematically important banks, right? And it has to maintain certain additional, you know, the capital surcharge in India as applicable to the GSIBs or the global systematically important banks, which are also working in our country, right? Which is proportional to their risk-weighted assets in our country. All right. So it is, there are such regulations which will be implemented to GSIBs also. All right. Next, optical ground wire, or that is called OPZW, right? So here, this is the news. It is basically a ground wire. It is a wire, simple, which is basically made up of optical cable. So it is an optical cable, right? So this cable will be used. First of all, it is in the news because this cable, first of all, can transmit the basically data, right? So it can transmit the photon, which is basically used for transmitting the signals, especially for for the internet providers, for the mobile service, you know, the users. So it will be used for internet as well as the mobile services uninterruptibly in certain, you know, in the hilly terrain or in the certain hilly states. So here, you know, to improve the telecom connectivity, especially in the hilly areas, the Power Grid Corporation of India Limited, which is also known as Power Grid, which is also PSU, has recently signed an agreement with the Himachal Pradesh State Electricity Board, that is also called HPSEBL, in Shimla, right, for utilization of 500 kilometers of the optical fiber ground wire. So it is basically optical fiber wire, which is basically already ground over there. And through the Power Grid, right, such telecom connectivity will be provided to hilly areas, right, especially in the Himachal Pradesh. Right. So here the telecom services will be provided, right, uninterruptibly, right, to the mobile and the internet users, right, especially to those people which are residing in such hilly areas, right. It is also known as optical ground wire, which is also known as OPGW, which is based on the IEEE standard, right, and it is basically a composite overhead ground wire, right, as you have seen also, all right. And it is a type of cable which is basically used in the overhead power lines, right? And such cable basically combines the functions of grounding and the communication, right? So it is just in quality for such cable, okay? Regarding construction of OPGW, you see basically it is a fiber composite ground wire. So it has the fibers. First of all, that is why we call them fiber cable, okay? It is basically having the tabular structure, right? Or it contains a tabular structure with one or more optical fiber in it. Okay, so the tabular structure will have one or more optical fiber, and it is basically surrounded by aluminium and the steel wires. Don't worry, in the last of this class you will have the diagram, right, of such whatever I am seeing here. So it is a technical specification of such wire. Okay, so you will have the diagram. So as I told you, it is a composite ground wire. So it is basically having the, you know, tabular structure, right? The tabular structure will have the one or more optical fiber, and it is basically surrounded by a layers of aluminum and steel wires, right? Here, the layer of aluminum and the steel wires serve to connect the tower to the ground, right? So whatever the towers, which is basically transmit, right, signals, they will be serving, or these wires will be serving to connect with them, right? And the optical fiber within the cable is used for transmitting the high speed data, right? These high speed data will be ultimately, you know, communicated to those people. So here you can see the schematic diagram of OPGW. So here the outer armor layer, which is made up of aluminum alloy. So it is outer armor layer. And then the second layer is basically consisting of the aluminum cad steel. Okay, it is the second layer, the black one. The third layer is basically consisting of the metallic or plastic tube. So it will be surrounding these fibers, all right. And the fourth is basically optical fibers, which is basically passing through this jelly. So it is a filling jelly. Through this filling jelly, the optical fibers basically passes through, which surround the metallic plastic tube, or which also surrounded by the aluminum cad steel, which is also surrounded by the outer armor layer, which is made up of aluminum alloy, right? So it is a basically structure or schematic diagram of OPGW. All right. So that's all. Thank you very much for attending this session. We'll meet tomorrow. Thank you.